What is network address translation, or NAT, how it works, and why was it invented? There are many videos out there on the topic, but most of them fail to mention perhaps one of the most fundamental principles allowing it to function at the scale it does today. Way back when the IP protocol was invented, nobody knew that billions of people will want to access the internet with multiple devices each. IP version 4 was developed to allow about 4.2 billion addresses, and somewhere in the 90s it became apparent that this will not be enough, so something had to be done. Development of next generation IP protocols was taking time, so temporary solutions were proposed, and one of them was that we could just reuse IP addresses. And the very basic idea of NAT was born. People could now create these network segments that would be incompatible for not using unique addresses and have them coexist with address translation. But that is not the end of the story. Things later evolved from there. Eventually, someone had the brilliant idea that we could pick specific IP ranges that would be used for private networks only. These should not be routed across the internet, so everyone can reuse them indefinitely to create as many private networks as they need. Now, this is the level of understanding that most people have, but have you ever asked yourself, how is this even possible? Translating one address to another is a pretty simple idea, but how exactly can multiple addresses be translated to one without breaking anything? How can several devices connect to countless servers on the internet, getting data sent back to them through a single IP? How is that data never mixed up if it is sent to the same address? Well, there are a couple of reasons. First of all, most internet communication doesn't happen directly between IP addresses. There is another layer on top, usually the TCP and the UDP protocols. Both of them share the same concept of ports. In fact, other uncommon transport protocols also tend to use them, even though technically they could use some different paradigm, but that's another story. In practice, almost every packet going through your router will contain port identifiers. After the destination IP address, the next 16 bits specify the source port, and another 16 bits specify the destination port. 16 bits translate to 65,536 ports. That is a lot. And since there are both source and destination ports, the granularity that you can have in communication between just two IP addresses is even greater, because every destination port could theoretically receive data from those 65,000 source ports and still be able to tell apart every single strand of communication or connection if we're talking about TCP, as UDP is technically a connectionless protocol. And that again is another story. The important thing is that thanks to ports, there is a ton of addressability on top of IP, and that is what NAT can make use of. Methods that rely on the use of ports could be more explicitly referred to as NAPT or PAT, but most just prefer NAT. Probably the most common application of NAT with ports is NAT Masquerade, sometimes called one-to-many NAT. It makes our lives a lot easier by automating most of the configuration, and it makes the lives of hackers a little more difficult. Here is how Masquerade works. You have one gateway that has a public IP, and when a device on its local network needs to reach a device on the internet, the packets that traverse the gateway will get altered. The source IP will be changed to the public IP, and the source port will get changed to one of the available ports on the gateway. A sort of automated source NAT is performed, where every communication attempt from the LAN gets a temporary port. Now, here's the fun part. The gateway keeps track of these changes and stores them in its memory so that it has a map. This is a very important step. If the server or device on the internet that was contacted sends any packets back to the gateway, a different alteration needs to take place. Using the previously created map, the gateway will be able to change the destination address and the destination port accordingly, so that they match the device on the local network. Without the outgoing translations being mapped, the incoming traffic could not be sorted. Now, if another device sends data to the same server, a separate entry is added to our map, and when the server responds, it will be able to reach our device on the LAN. Over time, these map entries will be removed, and different private network clients and different connections will be able to reuse the same external ports on the gateway. Sounds pretty good, but the fun doesn't stop here. This is only one type of mapping, and while very secure, it is also very strict and it can break a lot of peer-to-peer communication that people want to do. If two peers are both behind this type of NAT, they will not be able to establish direct communication between themselves even if they use NAT traversal techniques like hole punching. And whether you know it or not, many different kinds of software do this in the background. Games, torrents, voice over IP, and now networking solutions like ZeroTier and TwinGate are popular. Obviously, we don't want to break all these programs and solutions, so we need to do something differently. At the other end of the spectrum, there is endpoint independent mapping. When the gateway receives the packet and updates the map, instead of recording the exact remote endpoint, it could also record only the IP or even nothing at all. In that case, not only can the contacted server send replies, but also anyone on the internet. The port becomes exposed, and that comes with security risks. So most home routers will not do this unless you explicitly configure it. But you don't have to. Your MikroTik router and other Linux-based routers will actually do something brilliant. Masquerade will map data just like I showed you in the first example, but it will try to preserve the external port between different connection attempts coming from the same source port. So that means when a second connection attempt is made to a different endpoint, it is mapped to the same port. This is critical for peer-to-peer applications to do hole punching, which is initiated by first contacting a third-party server. But that is for another video. We just went into great detail on how Masquerade works, and in the process we learned about NAT mapping and how it can be implemented in many different ways. But there are other options besides Masquerade. Luckily, they use the same NAT map principles, so they are much easier to explain. Let's put things in perspective by listing all the common ways to do NAT, starting with the most simple. We have basic or static NAT. All it does is change one address to another. The ports and endpoints don't matter at all. Any exposed ports on the client can be reached through the external IP on the gateway. Then the next alternative is called dynamic NAT, and in this case, the gateway has a pool of IP addresses that it can dynamically hand out to many clients as needed. The ports and endpoints again do not matter. And then there's port forwarding, which is a cool method for exposing a single port on a LAN device as if it were an open port on your gateway. It is just one NAT map entry, and it can work together with Masquerade. You already know how that works. Finally, when you are ready, set up your own ISP and you want to squeeze everything out of your available public IPs, you can do carrier-grade NAT. It is kind of like Masquerade, but it uses specific IP address range and it allows you to limit the number of ports available to each client. Finishing things up, a noteworthy mention, hairpin NAT. Strictly speaking, it is just a common router feature that allows you to set up your NAT in a way where you can access a device on your LAN as if you were connecting from WAN. That's about it. I hope you enjoyed this. If you are new to the channel, make sure you like and subscribe. We are a router company and I'm like a tech nerd YouTuber or something. I do all the research myself and I do care about these videos a lot. So help me out here. Share this if you can and leave me a comment. What topic should we cover in the future? How did you find this video? Or maybe you just have a cool networking story to tell. Anyhow, take care.